Hello everyone, in the previous video we have seen the GATE 2004 questions. Now in this video we will be discussing about the GATE 2005 questions, all from the network layer and the transport layer. So let us look at all these questions one by one. So the first question says, the packets of the same session may be routed through different paths in which of the following? Option number 1 is TCP but not UDP. Option number 2 is TCP and UDP. Option number 3 is UDP but not TCP, and option number 4 is neither TCP nor UDP. So first of all, let us understand what the question is exactly saying. I mean, you should be able to understand the question before even solving it. If you cannot understand the question, you will not be able to solve it. See, multiple times I told you that TCP is a connection oriented protocol, and I told you that IP is a connection-less protocol. It is a connection-less protocol. And you can imagine something like this, that if this is a car, now this car is your IP protocol and TCP is sitting inside this car. So this is your TCP protocol. And whenever I'm saying connection-oriented protocol, that means TCP performs connection establishment before sending the data, before even sending the communication. And we said that this is a virtual connection, okay? And TCP ensures that the data should be delivered to the exact process, that is a process-to-process delivery, or you can say end-to-end delivery. Now, the biggest thing the students confuse is that when we say that TCP is a connection-oriented protocol, then we imagine that all the packets should follow the same path, but it is not the case. Actually, when we are saying TCP is a connection-oriented protocol, it means we do a connection establishment before sending the data, and in that connection establishment, we negotiate the various parameters. So parameters might be your segment size, parameter might be your window size, etc, etc. So we negotiate about the parameters, but all the packets will travel inside the IP, and an IP packet is a packet switching connection less protocol. It uses packet switching. Now, because an IP uses connection packet switching, that means a packet may take any route throughout the network. The packet can go through this route, a packet can go through this route, a packet can go through this route. A packet can go through any route in the network, but the delivery is ensured by TCP. So that is why we say that IP is a not very reliable protocol, but rather IP uses the TCP to become reliable. So IP uses packet switching, TCP is a connection oriented. So with the help of these two, we achieve reliability. In TCP, we have various parameters to ensure reliability. For example, we have sequence number field, we have so many different fields, that is why TCP is more reliable. But as you can see, UDP is very less reliable as compared to TCP, because UDP is having very minimum kind of information. So whenever you want to transmit any network time information and all these things where reliability is not required, then we use UDP protocol. Now, a packet of the same session may be routed through different paths in TCP or UDP. In both of the cases, packet can go through different paths. It is not necessary that whether it is a TCP packet, it should follow the same path. A TCP packet can also go through, this packets can also take different paths, because these packets are carried by IP. Even UDP packets are also carried by IP, and these IP packets can take different paths within the same session between the sender and the receiver. So they are saying the packets of the same session may be routed through different paths in. So that is option number 2, that is TCP and UDP. In both the cases, they can be routed through different paths. Okay. Do not confuse that in TCP, they will not be able to route in different paths. It will be. Okay. The next question is, the address resolution protocol is used for. So you should know where the address resolution protocol works. Now, this address resolution protocol is working in case of this ARP is a part. ARP is a in network layer. So as you know that there are various layers are there. We have application layer, we have application presentation session, then we have transport layer, After this, we have network layer, and then we have data link layer, and after this, we have physical layer. So in case of this network layer, so this ARP comes in the network layer, it comes in the lower portion of network layer, and this ARP protocol is used to get the MAC address of a device whose IP address you already know. That is, it is used to translate an IP address to a MAC address of a device. So option number one is saying finding the IP address from DNS, that is wrong. Option number two is saying finding the IP address of the default gateway, that is also wrong. Option number three, finding the IP address that corresponds to the MAC address, that is wrong, because this is an RARP, reverse address resolution protocol. And option number four is finding the MAC address that corresponds to the IP address, that is correct. So correct answer is option number four. Let us look at the next question. They are saying an organization has a class B network and it wishes to form subnet of 64 departments. And the subnet mask would be, what will be the subnet mask in this case? Now they are saying it is a class B network. So in a class B network, we use the first 16 bits as the network ID and the next 16 bit as the host ID. Now because we have to divide into 64 subnets, therefore we are going to choose the host ID bits to form subnets. And we need 64 departments, so we need to have to form 64 subnets. So from here, we have to choose bits. How many bits? These should be 2 raised to power, these should be x bits. In such a way, 2 raised to power of x should be equal to 64. Okay. And when we do subnet mask, in subnet mask, we make all the network ID bits as 1. So here, because it's class B networks, therefore the first 2 octets will be 255.255, because these octets are already representing the network ID, the first 16 bits. And now in the rest 16 bits, we have to choose these many bits to represent the subnet mask, to represent your network ID, subnet ID. So this should be equal to, you can take logarithm on both the sides, you will find out that 2 raised to power 6 is equal to 64. Hence we know that x is equal to 6. So from here we have to make 6 bits as 1. All the other bits will remain 0 in case of this case. So if you see this value, what is this value? This value is representing 252. Therefore the subnet mask will be 255.255.252.0. So correct answer here is option number 4, that is this will be the subnet mask. Now look at the next question. In a packet switching network, packets are routed from source to destination along a single path having two intermediate nodes. If the message size is 24 bytes, each packet contains a header of 3 bytes each, then the optimum packet size is. First of all, let us understand the question, what they are asking or telling in the question. They are saying that we have a sender and we have a receiver. And between this sender and the receiver, we have two intermediate nodes. These are two intermediate nodes. And at the sender side, we want to send a data which is of total 24 bytes. Now, and we have a header which is of 3 bytes each. Now, they are asking, if we want to send this 24 bytes through this network, now, what should be the packet size? How many packets can we divide this packet? And what should be the packet size? Now, there are two ways of solving these questions. One is your proactive way. That means you go from a top to down approach. But sometimes that you might not get an exact answer, but you have to get an approximate answer. And second is your bottom up approach. That means you check out all the options. You derive what is the time taken from all the options and then you find come to the answer. Okay. So we will be discussing about both these techniques, that is a top down as well as bottom up technique. Okay. We'll be able to understand this question very easily. I hope that you will enjoy this question. This is a very nice and beautiful question that they have given. Okay. So let us try to understand how to solve this kind of questions. So they're saying that we have a total of 24 bytes of data. Let us assume that packet size is x. Let packet size in which we are dividing this data is equal to x. okay, x bytes. Therefore, we can say the total number of packets will be 24 bytes divided by x. That means you are dividing this entire packet into this entire data into packets of size x each. Packets of size x each. Now, these many packets we can get. And in every packet, we have to use a 3 byte header. Therefore, we can say that packet size plus header, that is going to give us size which is 24 divided by, that is going to give us something which is x plus 3. This is x plus 3, okay, because packet size is x and we have to add 3 bytes of header, right? So then becomes x plus 3. Now we know how many packets will be there and we know what will be the packet size. Let us assume that these are k packets. These are total k packets just for simplicity purposes. Now we know that whenever we are going to transmit or use this concept to send this data, so concept of pipelining will come. That means for the first packet, all these three transmission delays will be added, but all the subsequent packets, only one transmission delay will be added. Okay, I hope that you have seen my videos on this. So for the very first packet, we have three transmission delay. Okay, so total time here will be transmission time of the first packet at S plus transmission time of the first packet, this is, let us suppose x, this is y, at x, plus transmission time of the first packet at y, this is for the first packet, okay, plus all the k minus 1 packets will be having only one transmission delay. So that is a maximum of this, that is a maximum of ts plus transmission time of s, comma transmission time of y, comma transmission time of x, maximum of all of them plus their propagation time. So let us suppose this is the propagation time, okay, this is x, y and z. Now I'm assuming these propagation delays as zero in this case, okay, and because they have not mentioned any bandwidth also, so I'm going to assume that these transmission delays will also be same. Therefore, we can say the total time will be 3 into transmission time for the first packet plus all the other k minus 1 packets will be having only one transmission delay. I hope that you understood this very easily. And we know what's the transmission time. So transmission time is length of the data packet upon bandwidth. And here the length of the data packet is x byte. And if you add header with it, so it will become x plus 3 divided by bandwidth. So you can change this value, so it is 3 into x plus 3 divided by bandwidth, the first case, plus k minus 1 into x plus 3 divided by bandwidth. Now in this question they have not mentioned bandwidth anywhere, so because they have not mentioned any kind of bandwidth, so we can assume any value for bandwidth, right? So we can even take this bandwidth as a variable, or we can assume any value. So for simplicity purposes, I'm just assuming some value for the bandwidth here, and I'm assuming that the value of bandwidth is 1, okay? So assuming these values as 1, therefore this will become, this entire equation will become 3 into x plus 3 plus k minus 1 into x plus 3. So solve this equation. After solving this equation, you are going to get something like this: 2x plus 3k plus kx plus 6. Now this is the important equation that you get. Okay, so you can note it down. I am rubbing the screen because I have very less space here. You can note it down, and we are continuing with it. Now the equation that we got is 2x plus 3k plus k into x plus 6, which is representing your total time, and in this total time we assume the bandwidth of the network as 1. Now we already know the value of k. We know that k is equal to 24 divided by x. Therefore we can also make this value as 2x plus 3 into 24 divided by x plus 24 divided by x into x plus 6. So solve this one, you'll get 2x plus solve this entire equation. I think so, if there's any mistake, let me just have a look at it. Right, so you can solve this entire equation and you'll get 2x plus 72 divided by x plus 30. You'll get something like this. Okay, so therefore we want to minimize here. Fine. So because we want to minimize, I think this is x, right? So in bottom we'll get x only. You can take LCM on both the sides. Let me just solve it up. So it is 2x plus 3 into 24. So that is 2, and I think it will be 72 divided by x plus this will become 24 plus 6. So this will become 2x plus 72x plus 30. You'll get this kind of equation, right? And you can solve this equation to get a value like this. Fine. Now on this equation you can apply differentiation because we want the optimum packet size. So we have to apply differentiation on this and then equate to 0. So if you apply differentiation on this, so this will become 2 plus, you have to apply d by dx. Okay, you have to differentiate with respect to x. So you'll get 2. From this you will get 72 divided by x square multiplied by minus 1 plus, from this it will become 0 plus 0 is equal to here. So here it will become 0 is equal to 0. So it is 2 minus 72 divided by x square is equal to 0. Now take this equation and find the value of x. And you'll see the value of x will become 6. Now the value of x is 6 and you already have the header size. Therefore the total packet size, that is the optimal packet size, will be 6 plus 3, which is equal to 9. Therefore the correct answer to this question is D, that is 9. This is one way of solving the question. And actually this is a better way, because this needs you have a proper conclusion, you have a proper solution of this question, and this is correct, right? But every time it will not happen that this answer will be exactly matching. Sometimes it will happen that answer will not be matching. Now for that case you have another way of solving the same problem. What you can do is, now this time you can use a reactive fashion. Reactive means you are going to react to the solutions. You are going to react to the options that are present here. For example, I can take the first option, then I'll take the second option, then I'll take the third option, and then I'll take the fourth option. I can take each of these options one by one to react to the solution. For example, the first option is saying the optimum packet size is 4. That means we have 1 byte of data plus 3 bytes of header. Okay, in the second case, 6 means we have 3 bytes of data plus 3 bytes of header. In the third case, we have 4 bytes of data plus 3 bytes of header. And the fourth case, we have total 6 bytes of data and we have 3 bytes of header. Okay, so this is the total that we have. Now in this case, you can find it out in the very first case. If you have total 24 bytes of data, so this will be divided into 24 packets. In the second case, it will be divided into 24 divided by this 3, so which is going to give us 8 packets. In the third case, we have 24 divided by 4, which is going to give us 6 packets. And in the fourth case, we have 24 divided by 6, which will give us 4 packets. This is the second way of solving. Now, we have to find out total transmission, total time in each of these cases. So for simplicity purposes, I'm assuming bandwidth as 1. So as you know, we have to apply the law of pipelining. So in this case, The first packet will be having transmission time, which will be multiplied by this, right? Because we have two intermediate nodes, and all the other packets, so which is k minus 1 packets, will be having one transmission delay. So because in this case, in the very first case, we have total 4 bytes of this. So we are going to have 3 into 4 divided by bandwidth is 1, plus all the 23 packets will be having 4 by 1. So it total, you can find out this value. In the second case, it will be 3 into 6 divided by 1 plus all the other packets, which are 8 packets. So that is 7 into 6 divided by 1. You can find out this value. Now in the third case, again in the third case here. So in the third case, it will become 3 into the size. We have total size of 7. 7 divided by 1 plus 5 into 7 divided by 1. And the fourth case, this will become 3 into 9 divided by 1 plus 3 into 9 divided by 1. And then you can calculate all these values and you can find out what is the minimum value. Now this way you will find out that this is the minimum value. So because it is a minimum value, hence the answer will be option number 2. So this will be a reactive fashion according to the options that are available or options that are present. Okay. Look at the next question. They are saying, on TCP connection, the current congestion window size is, congestion window is 4 KB. The current, it is the congestion window size. And the window size advertised by the receiver is 6 KB. The last byte sent by the is this much, and the last byte acknowledgement of the receiver is this much. Now what is the current window size? So window size is basically minimum from the congestion window size or the advertiser window size. So whatever the minimum values, that is always the window size. Here the congestion window size is 4 KB and advertised window size is 6 KB. So minimum value is 4, therefore the window size should be set to 4 KB. All the other data that is given after this here, this is complete wastage. This is given to confuse you. So 4 KB is basically 4096, right? So correct answer is B to this question. It's a very straightforward and easy question. Look at this question. They are saying, in a communication network, a packet of length L takes link L1. So we have a network where we have two links. One is a link L1 and second one is a link L2. Both are connected to some receiver. Now, link L1, the probability of packet taking the link L1 is P1 and the probability of packet taking the link L2 is P2. Now, they are saying, in case of link L1, the error probability is B1. In case of link L2, the error probability is B2. Now, probability that the packet will be received without any error via link L1 or L2. Now, you can see if a packet is going, then either the packet will go from L1 or the packet will go from L2, but packet cannot go from both of them. Therefore, we can say that these two events are mutually exclusive. So, hence we can say the probability that the packet will take link L1 is P1. And the error probability in link L1 is B1. So not having any error in L1 is 1 minus B1. Okay. In the same way, probability that the packet chooses link L2 is P2. And error probability of link L2 is B2. And not having error in L2 is 1 minus B2. Okay. Now in this case, because either the packet will choose either the link L1 or the packet will choose link L2, but not both of the links. In this case, the probability that the packet will choose link L1 is P1. And in that case, not having an error, this is the probability, right? Multiplied by L, right? Because this is the length of the packet. Okay. This is raised to power L. And now the probability that the packet chooses the link L2 is P2. and not having error probability is this one, and we have to send L bytes, therefore this is L. So this is the formula that we are getting. Now check if this formula is matching with any one of them. So the first option, this formula is matching, so correct answer is option number A. Okay. Now check out the next question here. This is again a very interesting question. They are saying a company has a class C network of address this, wishes to have three subnets, one of 100 host and two of 50 host each. Which of the following options represent a feasible set of subnets? So there are two ways of dividing the network. Assume this is your entire network. Now, first of all, I can divide the entire network in two subnets. So this is a subnet A and this is entire subnet B. And further, I can divide the subnet B into two subnets like this. Okay. Actually, because it is a class C network. So in a class C network, we have 24 bits in network ID and we have 8 bits in host ID. Now, and if you want to do subnetting, then we have to do subnetting from these 8 bits. And with these 8 bits, there are 256 networks are possible, sorry, hosts are possible. And we have to do subnetting. Therefore, out of this 256, we have to give 100 to this, at least 100 to this. There can be more, and 50 and 50 to this, and there can be more. This is the first way of breaking it up. Second is, I can divide the entire network into two parts, and I can divide the first network in two parts. So there are two ways of, you know, dividing this entire network. So if you see the first way, in this case, the network ID is 204.204.204.0. Now, if I have to do subnetting, so first of all, I have to divide this entire network into two equal parts. So for that, I'm going to choose a bit from this side. So in the first case, I'm going to make the first network, which is having a network ID, which is 204.204.204.0000000. So I'm just breaking this last part into bits. So if I'm going to keep the first bit as zero, so this can be network ID for the first network. And for this next half, I'm going to choose this bit as one. So this is 204.204.204.1000000. Now further, because we have to divide this part also in two equal parts, so I'm going to choose the second bits here. So either I can choose the second bit as zero or I can choose the second bit as one. So I'll get two addresses here, which is 204.204.204.1000000. And in the second case, we get 204.204.1100000. Okay. Now, if you see the network ID here, this network ID is 204.204.204.0. And here the subnet mask will be 255.255.255.128, because we have used one bit here. Okay. If you choose the second part here, in this second part, the first one is 204.204.204. Because we have chosen two bits here, so it will be 192. And the subnet mask, so this is 128. This is 128. And the subnet mask will be 255.255.255.192. And here, in the second case, it will be 204.204.204.192 and subnet mask will be this much. Okay. But if you see, this is not matching with any of these options. So that means they have divided this entire network using this criteria. So let's look at the second criteria now. This is the entire network. First of all, we have to divide the network into two equal parts, and then I'm going to divide the first part here. Okay. Fine. So if this is the entire network, we have to divide this network into two equal parts. So the first part will be having the network ID, which is 204.204.204.0. And the second part will be having a network ID, that is 204.204.204.128. This is the network IDs. Further, I'm going to divide this into two equal parts. So first part will be having a network ID, that is 204.204.204.0, and second will be having a network ID, that is 204.204.204.0000. DRDO.204.64 because we have chosen two bits from this. Okay, so two bits, right? So here for this, because we have chosen two bits from this side, so subnet mask will be 255.255.255.2 bits, means 192. And for this one also same subnet mask will be there, that is 255.255.255.192. okay, and for this the subnet mask will be 255.255.255. we have chosen one bit, so 128. Okay, and is it matching with any of the options here? You can have a look at it. So we have 0 and this is not matching, I think. And the second one, so 192 here, we have 0.0 and 192, that is fine. We have .64, again this is not correct, I think. So let us look at the last one here. So we have 0.192, fine. 64.192, that is fine. 128.128, that is fine. So correct answer is option number D. Now this is a very easy and straightforward question. You can easily solve this question if you have seen my videos on subnets, subnetworks in the IP addresses. I know that most of you do not understand this solution. You can only understand it after watching my videos on computer networks, that is IP addressing. Okay, so now let us look at the questions from 2006.